here, but would you go that side?
Down there?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. We're going to begin by listening to a hymn. I have to admit that I chose the hymns without the slightest idea why, but it just seemed they were somewhat appropriate, so you can try and work out for yourselves if there is anything there. But the first hymn is, In Christ There Is No East or West.
Thank you.
this month, I shall celebrate 40 years as a priest. I'm just hoping and praying that I can have a son Eucharist, but I have a horrible feeling I won't be able to. That's the way it is. Anyway, it's lovely to be here with you again and be back, as it were. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Welcome in the name of Christ. God's grace, mercy, and peace be with you.
And also with you.
Say standing. Fine. We say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments, and to live in love and peace with all. We say together, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sin and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We stand and say together the glory. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. As we stand, let us pray. God of truth, help us to keep your law of love and to walk in ways of wisdom, that we may find true life in Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. Sit for our people.
The reading comes from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians, starting at chapter 4, verse 13. But just as we have the same spirit of faith, that is in accordance with Scripture, I believe, and so I spoke, we also believe. And so we speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Because we look at not what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, my sheep hear my voice, says the Lord. I know them and they follow me. Hallelujah. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The crowd came together again so that Jesus and his companions could not even eat. When his family heard it, they went out to restrain him, for people were saying, he has gone out of his mind. And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem said, he has Beelzebul, and by the ruler of demons he casts out demons. And he called them to him, and spoke to them in parables. How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but his end has come. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his property without first tying up the strong man. Then indeed the house can be plundered. Truly I tell you, people will be forgiven for their sins and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit can never have forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they have said, he has an unclean spirit. Then his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you. And he replied, who are my mother and my brothers? And looking at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. What a strange pair of readings we have had this morning. A rather bizarre account of Jesus' family coming to collect him because they think he is mad. And a somewhat obscure passage from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. I readily admit that I have struggled with them over the past week and struggled to see what they might have to say to us. My attention finally settled on Paul's letter. It is always helpful to understand something of the context. So, sometime after Paul had written his first letter to the Corinthians, a group of outsiders arrived in Corinth. Paul presumably received a report concerning them from his friends at Corinth. Now, these outsiders were Christian preachers, but their message was that Christianity was a vitally renewed Judaism within which certain people possessed the power to work miracles. These outsiders claimed to possess that extraordinary power. Indeed, they maintained that they were themselves sources of divine power. Paul referred to these people as super apostles, a clearly sarcastic designation, but a title that they may have been, which may have been their own self-designation. Although the super apostles clearly came from Jewish Christian circles, they were like other Hellenistic religious propagandists of that day, who had a flashy, obviously powerful style of ministry, powerful in proclamation and powerful in deeds. So we see in our reading this morning, Paul's impassioned discussion of the character of his ministry and the nature of true Christian service. Paul appears to be under fire from these preachers, and he believes there is more at stake than just his reputation. The point of the controversy for Paul is nothing short of the truth of the gospel. Paul regards himself and other believers as servants of the gospel, whose lives and patterns of ministry are shaped by the gospel itself. Paul is defending the legitimacy and authenticity of his own apostolic ministry in the face of these rival apostles who claim superior wisdom, apparently possess letters of recommendation, and boast about their radiant faces that reflect Moses, like Moses, the glory of God. Paul therefore says that the glory of God or the risen life of Jesus reaches us only through the dying of Jesus. Our participation in his glorious life, it comes only through our participation in his ignominious death. That is, in our daily dying in service to the gospel. It all sounds a bit gloomy, really. But there is another sign. As Paul says, we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and will bring us with him and with you into his presence. This is in stark contrast to the claims of Paul's opponents. The risen life of Jesus is outside ourselves. It's beyond ourselves. It's out on the horizon of the future where it promises to meet us. It is out of this hope that Paul speaks the gospel. What has happened to the crucified Jesus in his resurrection into glory now awaits each of us. We will be gathered into glory by the power of God. We can spend our life in this world for God because God is already giving us new life that will endure beyond the present into the context of God's new creation, which he has already prepared for us and which is not yet fully present. So Paul offers a series of contrasts. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. Battered on the outside, we are sustained and renewed by the life of God within. And in bodily weakness, spiritual renewal can often take place. He also says this slight momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. The glories of heaven endure, but the griefs of earth end. And thirdly, we look not at what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. There are important realities that the eye cannot see. In each of these, Paul points out the inferiority of present existence in comparison to God's promised future, which is already being made real. Resurrection is waiting ahead of us. When the process of outward decay finally runs its course, our earthly tent will be dismantled. Our fragile human body will not simply be abandoned, but will be replaced by a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The new life God gives will be solid and enduring, physical as well as spiritual, a time when friends will be gathered in the nearer presence of Jesus. Over the past 18 months, as we have all grappled with the impact of this pandemic, there can be few of us who, like me, have not struggled with the lockdowns. Things that we took for granted, suddenly taken away. Not being able to see family and friends, not being able to hug or have physical contact with loved ones, being limited in what activities we can engage in, and much, much more. It has, in my case anyway, given me an even greater awareness of our mortality. In the words of the Book of Common Prayer, we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succour all them who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Clearly, we do well to reflect on the transitory nature of our existence. Just as Paul faced in our reading, it has been a test of faith. Faith in a future which is not in our hands or in the government's hands, but in the hands of God. As Paul wrote to the Christians at Rome, I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Or, as he said in our reading this morning, for we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. O God, the strength of all those who put their trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers, and because through the weakness of our mortal nature, we can do no good thing without you, grant us the help of your grace, that in the keeping of your commandments, we may please you both in will and deed, and through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So let us stand and declare our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in the words of the Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray for the Father.
Eternal God, help us to understand more fully those things we cannot touch and see. May the Spirit of truth be our guide, and the easy picking of the things within our reach be resisted. Your Son showed us that we can live life both righteously and abundantly. Give us the confidence, Lord, to stretch ourselves and test ourselves, knowing that you are there to support and encourage, to forgive and welcome back. Help us to trust you always. Lord, in your mercy, give to your church the grace that gives life and hope, the unity that binds believers, and the vision that can inspire non-believers as well as the faithful. Help us to see the church as an extension of our families, just as your Son viewed those outside his family as his brothers and sisters. As Father of all, we look to you for direction and protection. But we pray also for the loving justice which you have shown through your Son. Lord, in your mercy, let all the world in every form sing and rejoice in your creation. We pray that in our exploration and enjoyment we seek always to be good stewards and wise users of our environment, never forgetting to whom we owe our life, our planet, our universe. Just as we threaten to spoil the paradise of Eden through disobedience, so we run the risk of losing our second chance, the new covenant. Give us the strength and will to make amends, to follow your Son's true way, as we pray for those parts of the world in need of your care and our attention, including especially the Middle East. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We remember the sick who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. And in particular, we pray today for Sheila Reese, for Caterpillar, and for Molly Lynn. Let them know the comfort of your love and give them the hope of better things. And in a moment of silence, we pray for those known personally to us. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for the departed, for those who now rest with you in your eternal kingdom, remembering especially Jackie. May the grief of those who mourn be heard in heaven and shared with loving friends. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Notices, John. Notices, yes.
Two quick ones. Next Sunday, of course, is Songs of Praise, so there is no service here at 9:30. Chris Pilot and some of the Angel Voices should be here again to lead us at 6 o'clock, and we're hoping to have some refreshments outside, provided the weather's all right. I think we can do it now. The other one is, some of you may have seen this, Bob Barge has set up a plant zone outside his house at 35 Parkway. It's an honesty table, but there's certainly a very good display from the picture on Facebook. The idea is, take something in that you don't need and leave it for part with a price on it if you can, and leave it there, and then go and buy something else for your garden, and the money comes to the church. And spread the word, because some people won't see it on Facebook.
And if you want to follow the words of the hymn during the communion, it will be number 88 in the hymn book. Number 88. Would you please stand? Blessed are the peacemakers, they shall be called children of God. We meet in the name of Christ and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of peace with a little wave.
Christ and with Christ
and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Draw near to faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you. Eat in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal Father, we thank you for nourishing us with these heavenly gifts. May our communion strengthen us in faith, build us up in hope, and make us grow in love for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
Amen.
The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Words of our final hymn are number 281, 281, He Who Would Valiantly.
Love and service.